Can they do it again? Can the Wolverines win the West Regional and advance to the Final Four for the second year in a row? Yes, they can. I'll explain why next with our NCAA Tournament preview here on Michigan Podcast.
But there's going to be one team that's going to play solely as a team. No man is more important than the team. No coach is more important than the team. The team, the team, the team.
Looks deep for Anthony Carter. Waits for it. Tip caught.
This is no time for that. In the pocket and a sack. Tim Jamison.
Brady gets terrific.
Throws it. Get it. Touchdown. Knight again.
Schultz just before Frizzell got it. And a leaping interception by Woodson.
Harbaugh back to throw over the middle. Caught by Collier at the 5 on his feet. Touchdown, Michigan.
On its way. It's good.
He's 5'7", 179 pounds, a junior at Michigan. But Jamie Morris packs a wallop, and he delivers for Bo Schembechler.
And here's your first play. Pressure coming. Sack. It is Glenn Steele, number 81, who fought his way through the traffic.
Option. And Robinson calls his own number, and he's going to score. Oh, an easy touchdown for Ron Robinson and Michigan.
Win it. We're going to win the championship again because we're going to play as a team. And when we play as a team and the old season is over, you and I know it's going to be Michigan again. Michigan.
Go Blue, I'm Steve Deace. Welcome to this week's episode of Michigan Podcast, solely devoted to the beginning of the madness, the march through March, hopefully ending all the way to the Final Four in Minneapolis come April, begins this week for the Michigan Wolverines. We'll cover it with our good friend, Michael Spath from WTKA in Ann Arbor, as well as the Wolverine Digest a little bit later on. But for those of you wondering, can they pull it off again? And doesn't this look a little familiar? West Regional, Montana in the first round, Florida State again, and Gonzaga in the top half of the West bracket. Indeed, Yogi Berra, it is some deja vu all over again. But there are, I think, five factors playing in favor of the Wolverines running through the West Regional bracket for a second year in a row. Let's go through those. Can Michigan make the Final Four again? Here's the first factor in the Wolverines' favor heading out to the West Regional. They've got a very favorable draw. I mean, I think it's for the second year in a row, I think this is the most favorable draw that any of the Big Ten contenders have. I mean, let's start at the bottom in my hometown of Des Moines. I'm taking Noah to see the game on Thursday night against Montana. You know, Montana has a bit of a quirky style, took Michigan some time to adjust to that last year. Now they know what's coming. You look at Nevada and Florida. Nevada is a team without a lot of depth, has struggled to live up to the hype this year. They've had a couple of injuries as well. Florida probably played its way into the tournament here in the final week. They've got some young guards that I think Michigan's defense could give them some problems, and I think Michigan will have a definitive home court advantage in all of those games, Thursday and Saturday in Des Moines. And you look through the rest of this bracket, you look at Texas Tech. I'm fascinated to see people on television picking Texas Tech to eliminate Michigan and using Michigan's offensive woes and droughts at times as the reason why. Yes, Texas does have the number one defensive efficiency ahead of Michigan at number two, but they played the 53rd toughest schedule in the country. We've played the 17th. And their offensive efficiency is 37th. Ours is 18th. It looks to me like Texas Tech is a somewhat less talented version of really the team that Michigan wants to be. So I think it's a very favorable draw. I think we've seen this from Gonzaga in the past. Get a nice win or two in the non-conference that gets everybody's attention, play nobody for 3.5 months. And then we get to March. And with the exception of a couple of years ago when they did get to the national championship game and probably should have won it over North Carolina, they're kind of more known for entertaining flameouts this time of year than they are for getting the job done. So I think it's a favorable draw for Michigan, which brings us to our second factor, I think, pointing to Michigan repeating in the West Regional. The college basketball world, I think, has forgotten how good the Big Ten is. If you go back to the non-conference, the Big Ten was the number one league coming out of the non-conference season. We forget in the net rankings, that's the new metric that replaced the RPI for the NCAA Tournament Selection Committee. I mean, the league had 11 of the top 50 teams heading into Christmas. I mean, Indiana was beating Louisville. Ohio State had two quad one road wins in the non-conference. That's rare to get in this day and age. And, you know, they were one of the last teams with a bye into the NCAA tournament this year. I think what's happened is these teams have all been playing each other for the last couple of months. They're very familiar with one another as well. They've been playing this grueling 20-game schedule. I mean, look at Penn State down there. Penn State only won 7 Big Ten games, 14, 13, 12. They were the 10th seed in the conference tournament. They're, I think, in the top 40 overall in KenPom's power ratings right now. So this is the deepest league in the country this year. It's got more NCAA tournament bids than any other league. And I think the college basketball world has forgotten how good this league is because familiarity breeds contempt. Let me give you a baseball analogy. You know, you got the unbalanced schedules in baseball these days. Suppose the teams in the American League East played the bulk of their divisional games at the end of the season. You know, so they built up these nice records, you know, beating teams from all the other divisions. And then the Yankees and Red Sox and the Rays, and to a lesser degree, the Blue Jays, all played those 19 games against one another the last month and a half. What would happen to everybody's stats? What would happen to people's WAR, ERA, batting averages, etc.? People would be talking about, well, maybe the American League East really isn't that good. Well, I think that's kind of what's happened here to the Big Ten. We have forgotten how good the league is. The third factor, I think, that favors Michigan is Michigan is one of the Super 7, the only teams in the country that are in the top 20 in both offensive and defensive efficiency, according to KenPom. And why does that matter? Because going back to when KenPom began doing advanced analytics for college basketball in 2002, every team that has won the national champion but one, Connecticut, the Shabazz Napier year, every team but one, so we've got 18 years of data there, every team but one has been in the top 20 in both offensive and defensive efficiency. And heading into the tournament, Michigan is one of only 7 teams that can make that claim. And again, they did it against the 17th toughest schedule in the country, according to KenPom as well. The fourth factor, I think, pointing towards Michigan repeating in the West Regional is Michigan's going to have the best point guard in the region with Xavier Simpson, and guards matter most in March. I mean, here's the reality. Those two guys right there on the other side of the screen of me, Cassius Winston, Xavier Simpson. Xavier Simpson has shut down every point guard he has faced this year except that guy. And that guy's the Big Ten Player of the Year. All right. So it's no crime. I mean, he's held his own. It's just Cassius Winston's a phenomenal basketball player. All right. So I think Michigan has the best point guard in the region with Xavier Simpson. And I think, as we have seen time after time after time, guards are what matter the most in March. And then finally, the fifth and final factor, I think, favoring Michigan making another memorable run through the West Regional and on the way to Minneapolis in the Final Four, John Beilein. I mean, John Beilein right now, amongst active college head coaches in a Power 5 conference, has the best win percentage against the point spread. It's like 65 or 66% in the NCAA tournament. So you go back to his days at West Virginia and now at Michigan, his ability to prepare on the fly, to take advantage of teams with short preparation. I mean, it's one of the reasons why Michigan's tournament record in general under John Beilein has been one of the best in the country. So I think you're talking about one of the best X's and O's coaches. And when you look at the rest of that region, You know, I think Chris Beard is a guy that's becoming a stud at Texas Tech. You know, Mark Few's a really good coach at Gonzaga, but again, you know, a lot of that, he didn't build that program. Dan Munson did. He's done a great job sustaining it, but a lot of that program has been built off of beating Pepperdine and San Francisco and St. Mary's. So I think there's a clear coaching advantage in that region as well. So if you've got the best point guard and the best coach in a region, I kind of like your chances to win that region, which is why I do think Michigan will be back in Minneapolis in the Final Four the first weekend in April. And you know what? I think they're going to face a familiar foe on semifinal Saturday. Are you ready for Michigan, Michigan State, the fourth? We'll discuss that and more with our good friend Michael Spath from WTKA in Ann Arbor next. We are taking things to the next level on our website at WolverineDigest.com, and we have upped the ante with the content in the last few days, and you're going to be seeing this on a daily basis. There you can see each morning, it's a good Michigan morning. We're doing little videos on some of the big news stories first thing in the morning from the Michigan Man Cave there. I'm rolling out of the rack, putting a hat on to cover the hat hair, and just letting it rip there from inside the Maize and Blue Man Cave. So that and a ton of news stories we are updating constantly on our website at Wolverine Digest. So if you're wondering, hey, how can we keep up with what you guys are doing and thinking in between episodes of Michigan Podcast, check out the website, WolverineDigest.com. And we're updating it constantly, and all the content is free, and we keep you updated on everything Michigan related that everybody else is covering as well. Kind of one-stop shopping, if you will, for the Maize and Blue. WolverineDigest.com. Back here on Michigan Podcast with our good friend Michael Spath from WTKA in Ann Arbor and Wolverine Digest. Good to see you, Michael. How are you?
I'm doing great, guys. It's a terrific week to be alive, is it not?
It is. You know me, I can do college football 365, but the greatest single sporting event is the NCAA tournament. There's absolutely nothing like it. And I just, regardless, and I say this every year since we've been back to being a regular, but for those that are too young to remember, you and I are old enough, and there's plenty others in our audience old enough, the lost decade of Michigan basketball and what it was like from 1999 to 2008 to not be a part of this. And there were really, except for a couple of years under Amaker, you weren't even, you know, worried about whether you were on the bubble. Like, you weren't even a factor in this process. And so to be a regular part of one of the great times of Americana, again, it's one of the things I am the most grateful to John Beilein over, is to get us back to this point again.
No, I agree with you. And that's very eloquently stated. I hadn't thought about that until you brought it up. But yeah, I mean, year after year, with a few exceptions here and there for John Beilein, we've known that Michigan's going to be in the tournament. We've known that Michigan's going to be you know, a top five or top six seed in the tournament, this year being a number two seed. It's been great fun because not only have they made the tournament, but they've made a lot of runs, you know, multiple Sweet 16s, obviously two trips to the Final Four, another Elite Eight with Nick Stauskas there. And so every week, every time the Michigan's playing in these tournaments, they're playing in the second weekend. And I don't know about you, Steve, but for me, there's something so incredibly enjoyable about getting past that first weekend and just what the possibility exists, because I think you and I and everybody else should know this too. I always look at the NCAA tournament, and there's a reason they call it March Madness, because so many crazy things happen. Duke has lost early round games. Michigan State has lost early round games. You know, Connecticut has lost early round games. Everybody, Kansas gets bounced early on in the tournament. Everybody suffers like one crazy bad game at some point in their career. And so for me, just to get that second weekend and realize, like, okay, you got past the madness. Anything after that is gravy, is always the goal and what makes that second week of the tournament and that Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday just so incredibly enjoyable. So no, I can't wait. It's going to be a lot of fun. And I think as you and I will talk about it, I'm sure that we both have Michigan getting to this, at least the Sweet 16.
I think Michigan's going to win the West Regional again. I open up the show today laying out five reasons why. I thought maybe we'd reset those and get your take on whether you agree or disagree. The first one is it's a favorable draw. I think it's the second year in a row. Michigan, you know, you and I talked about this last year. I know everybody wanted that seat in that spot in Detroit, but I've always agreed with John Beilein. It's the draw. The draw is more important than the seed. I thought we got the most favorable draw of all the Big Ten contenders last year, and I think we did again this year as well. I live here in Iowa, as you know. I watch a ton of Big 12 basketball. I don't think Texas Tech's going to beat Michigan. I don't. To me, you know, Texas Tech is to Michigan what Michigan is to Virginia. Like, I look at Virginia. Virginia's Michigan with better shooters. Okay, Texas Tech is Michigan with less offensively skilled players. You know, they're 37th in offensive efficiency. Michigan's 18th. They played the 53rd toughest schedule. We played the 17th. I'm wondering if some of these guys on, you know, ESPN are just looking for another team to pick, so they're picking them to be original. I get that, I guess. But I think Michigan has a very favorable draw. Nevada's been a team battling injuries, hasn't really lived up to the hype. Florida has a team with freshman guards that wasn't in the tournament a week ago, probably played themselves in this last week. I can tell you there's a strong pocket of Michigan fans here in Iowa. There'll be a lot of Michigan fans that will travel. I mean, they're going to be the home team in Des Moines this weekend. So I like Michigan's draw quite a bit. So I think they have a favorable draw. Your thoughts on that?
Yeah, no, I agree with you completely. I'm sorry, my cat just jumped up on my lap.
That's all right.
So I'm gonna throw him off of me here. Sorry about that.
That's okay. We can get a 2-for-1 deal. He can. Let's find out what he thinks. His picks might even be better than mine.
He makes a lot of noise. He's going to meow here at some point. There's no split loyalty in this house. The cat is all Michigan.
Yeah. For those that don't know, Michael is married to a Sparty. So that's what he's referring to. Yes.
Yeah. She's delightful, but not during basketball season. You know what? I honestly, Steve, I agree with you. And when I look at that draw right there, I mean, Gonzaga is, there's a reason that Michigan State fans are decrying the fact that they're playing Duke, is that Gonzaga is the easiest number one seed. Mm-hmm. And Florida State, I just don't buy in on the Florida State, you know, excitement. I think that they are the same team that they've always been. And that's a team that is going to scare a couple people. And but there's a reason that they can't crack through in the top three in the ACC, because they just can't play with any type of consistency. Honestly, the game that scares me the most is probably the second round game. I know you said Nevada hasn't played up to their potential and Florida's got some young guards. But I just think that's a time where, you know, you could be, I don't want to say Michigan be overlooking, but I think that second round game is always the one of the toughest ones that Michigan faces. I'm with you on Texas Tech. I do think that Buffalo is intriguing, but that, you know, they're probably as far as the Sweet 16. So I really like this draw.
I think Michigan's going to play Buffalo in the Sweet 16.
I think that's possible. I think the Michigan, I'm with you. I'm trying to take the homer hat off for a little bit and go with, you know, the break it down and look at it analytically and, you know, study my KenPom and study some of the other websites. But I keep on coming back to the fact that I like Michigan to come out of this region. And then after that, if they're playing Michigan State or Duke, I don't know that I feel very good about it. But yeah, I certainly think that there's a return trip to the Final Four that's very likely for Michigan this year.
When we get to the end of this, I have a question regarding Michigan and Michigan State I want to get your take on that you maybe should consider posing to your audience when I throw this one at you later. But we'll get there eventually. But back real quick on Gonzaga. If I'm Gonzaga, I'm rooting like hell for Baylor in that first round matchup. I do not want to have a quick turnaround against that matchup zone of Syracuse. I don't see anything like that, you know, in the West Coast Conference. And Tyus Edney is back for the Cuse. So now I've got a quirky defense with an NBA level talent to score the basketball on the other end. I saw what they did to Michigan State last year in that exact situation. I don't want any part of that at all. At all. If I'm Gonzaga, I'm all Baylor Bears. I want to see Baylor win that first round matchup. Here's the second factor I think that's in Michigan's favor in this region is I think the college basketball world forgot how good the Big Ten is. Forgot that we went into Christmas with 11 teams in the top 50 of the net. That, you know, Indiana had two very impressive non-conference wins. So did Wisconsin. Ohio State actually had two quad one road wins in the non-conference. Those are tough to get. We saw Iowa blow through the 2K tournament in New York City. We saw what Michigan did to North Carolina. Like, I don't get why North Carolina is the number one seed. They lost by almost 10 points at home to Kentucky. They got freaking boat raced by Michigan. They didn't win the ACC regular season. They didn't win the ACC tournament. I have no idea why they're a number one seed. I think because the Big Ten's played these 20 games with all these teams playing each other, and Big Ten officials allow a certain level of clutching, grabbing, and physicality that's not allowed in the rest of the college basketball world. I think a lot of the analysts are sleeping on the Big Ten. I mean, I pointed out earlier, look at Penn State. They were the 10th seed in the Big Ten tournament. They're a top 40 team on KenPom right now in terms of overall efficiency. So your thoughts on that?
It's interesting. I think if Zion Williamson doesn't get hurt a couple of times, that North Carolina is probably not even a number two seed.
I don't disagree with that. Yeah. They lost to Virginia twice.
Yeah.
Their only two wins are beating Duke against without Zion Williamson. You're exactly right.
They got so much credit for that. And we saw, I mean, yeah, they played a great game against Duke in the ACC semifinals. But I think we saw that, they're a team that can be beat. And I think any team can be beat this year, including Duke. I think when you look at it, the Big Ten, I mean, there's a reason that they're ranked number one throughout the year by the advanced metrics. There's a reason that they were considered the best conference in the non-conference season. And then somehow, because maybe they didn't have a dominant team, they didn't have, Michigan State lost a couple games to Indiana, Purdue looked flawed against Minnesota, and Michigan lost that game to Penn State. Suddenly they just got knocked for that. And I don't think that's really fair. I agree with you. I think there's four teams and maybe five teams in the Big Ten that can make the Sweet 16 when you look at the matchups. And I'll tell you, the one team I don't want to sleep on at all is Iowa. Iowa starts off with Cincinnati. They play Tennessee in the second game. And Iowa has a great combination of guys that can be able to hit the outside shot. And yet they can go down low to Tyler Cook and Garza. They also got some gamers in Wisecamp and Bohannon. I think that's a team that really could break up some brackets and some and really cause some consternation among Tennessee fans and then that. So I would not be shocked to see five teams in the Sweet 16. I do think Michigan State, Michigan, Purdue all have pretty favorable roads to get there. And then look for one more of those teams to make it happen. But, just as an early predictor, I have in my Final Four on the left-hand side of the bracket, I have Michigan State playing Michigan and eliminating, Gonzaga and Duke. And then on the right-hand side, one ACC and one SEC team. And I think the Big Ten will end up coming out looking pretty good in this NCAA tournament.
Well, we haven't compared notes, but it sounds like our Final Fours are very similar. We'll talk about that in a second. The next factor, I think, that favors Michigan. Michigan's one of only seven teams in the country this year that head into the tournament top 20 in both offensive and defensive efficiency. Since KenPom began in 2002, Michael, every national champion except UConn with Shabazz Napier a few years ago has been in the top 20 of both of those numbers. The other six teams joining Michigan are Michigan State, Kentucky, North Carolina, Virginia, Gonzaga, and Duke. So the metrics there tend to line up with what a team looks like when it goes on this kind of a March run.
Yeah, I mean, I think those are the six best teams in the tournament. And I know that stat. I've heard that stat. I think you and I have talked about that stat before. I think that makes, it makes a lot of sense. I mean, not all six of those teams is going to advance to the final, to the Elite Eight and get there. But chances are that one or two or three of them are in the Final Four because they are the best offense and defensive teams consistently throughout the season. And I think one of the things when you look at this Michigan defense, especially, people talk about how hard it is to defend, to play against John Beilein. That's to play against John Beilein's offense. And certainly that's been, a source of, a frustration for the Wolverines this year. But they have not played that very few teams that Michigan has faced or will face. Certainly not, maybe Montana because they played them a year ago, but Florida, Nevada, Texas Tech, Buffalo, Gonzaga, if they play any of these teams, none of them have faced Michigan's defense. None of them are going to be ready for what Michigan does defensively. I think as long as Michigan stays out of foul trouble, then that stat of being, one of the top 20 most efficient offense and defenses in the country is really going to come to help Michigan and kind of showcase just why that stat is so important, because you're a team that gets it done on both ends of the floor, and very few teams are capable of doing that. One, look at Iowa, great offensive team, terrible defensive team. I think that you find a lot more of that in the NCAA tournament until you get to the very end.
So let's put these final two stats together that are, because they kind of go together. The final two factors that I think favor Michigan winning the mm-hmm. West Regional again. The fourth one is Xavier Simpson. When you survey the point guards in this region, I think he's the best point guard in this region. He has essentially erased every team's point guard we played this year, except the guys in the that one photo with, who just happens to be the Big Ten Player of the Year. Listen, if all you can say is I can guard everybody except the very best player, I think most coaches are going to probably take that. And then I think the other factor is the head coach and John Beilein. John Beilein right now has the, among active coaches in the Power Five, the best win percentage in the NCAA tournament against the point spread. I think just his level of preparation compared to the difficulty of preparing for Michigan on the other side, particularly with these short windows. I think if you've got the best coach and you have the best point guard in your region, that's a pretty potent combination this time of year.
Yeah, you know, I think it's another reason that we're so fortunate to have John Beilein as the Michigan head coach. I mean, there's a reason that, you know, everybody says that he's so tough to play against and match up with in the NCAA tournament. The track record's there. He wins. He gets his guys prepared better than a lot of coaches do. I mean, it's a tough thing to turn around. You win a game, there's a lot of emotion. Also, you got to turn around and be ready for a different opponent that, you know, how much time could you truly spend on that opponent in the days leading up to that first NCAA tournament game? You know, maybe if you're the 2 seed or for the 1 seed or the 3 seed, you can spend a little bit more time on some of those ones that you could face. But I mean, he's done it over and over and over again, regardless of who the competition was. And if you go back to even to, you know, I had Zach Novak on my show last week, and we talked about that game against Tennessee that they won. I think it was his junior year, and then they came back and they lost to Duke in the next one, but they were, you know, they lost to Duke by two. A couple years before that, they beat Clemson in an NCAA tournament game, and they came back and they lost to Oklahoma by just a few points. And even in times where they've lost and they've been the underdog by a lot, they've given that second round team huge fits because few teams can do that turnaround like Michigan can. And so you're right. I give John Beilein a lot of credit. He's admitted that there's been some flaws and he has not been able to completely figure out Michigan State. But that is the exception, not the rule. I mean, he seems to be able to figure out everybody else. And with Xavier Simpson, yeah, I agree with you. I mean, he is probably the best point guard in the region, not the best shooting point guard, but Michigan hasn't needed that much of it this year. I think the one thing, and we haven't really brought up his name, we haven't really talked about is, you know, is the Jordan Poole factor. And I think when you look at it, he just can't cost you a game with his lapses and with his poor shot selection. I don't think he will in these first couple, but I'd be curious to see what happens after that. But John Beilein even said, you know, just this week after the Michigan State game, that there's five or six possessions in that game. That's what it came down to. Five or six possessions in the game at Chrysler. It came down to five or six possessions in the game at the Breslin Center. That Michigan just treats the basketball like it's no big deal. Treats it an offensive possession. Like they've got, you know, a million of these to go through. And it's those five or six possessions in those games that ultimately cost Michigan. And he gave a lot of credit to Michigan State. I don't know if they deserved it entirely, but he said that they never waste any possessions, that they treat it like they're the prize. And but he noted, you know, Jordan Poole, and he noted, you know, Iggy Brazdeikis, and he noted Charles Matthews. There were five or six possessions where they had terrible shots. They just stood around. They didn't move the ball. Got stagnant offensively, and that's the difference in those games. And so if he can weed that out here during crunch time during the NCAA tournament, I do think that we'll be talking about Michigan in the Final Four.
Chris Ballas at the Wolverine compared Jordan Poole to Sean Higgins this week. And I went a couple days ago and rewatched the 89 semifinals and finals. And holy crap, is that a good comparison? I mean, even Billy Packer is sounding like Dan Dockage talking about Jordan Poole. Billy Packer's like, dude, Sean Higgins just out here just jacking up shots. Yeah. Brett Musburger's like, apparently Sean Higgins has never seen a shot he doesn't like. And then he turns around at the buzzer and hits one of the most memorable shots in Michigan history against Illinois, similar to the exact conversations with Jordan Poole. And of course, he hit maybe the most memorable shot other than Higgins' shot in the history of Michigan basketball last year in the tournament. So I thought that was quite a comparison.
We've talked about this a lot. I think the thing is that he doesn't believe there's any shot that he takes that's a bad shot.
Right. Right.
I mean, that's really what it comes down to. I mean, even the ones that are terrible shots that we can all agree are terrible shots, I think in Jordan Poole's mind, he looks at it.
Hey, Michael, hold up. I think Matt McQuaid just pumped fake from the 3-point line and got fouled
okay.
again.
Okay. He went up. Oh.
I did this week, and you probably saw it on our site. It was the 1-year anniversary anyway, but I'm like, you know what? I'm too hard on this kid. I am. I got to remember he's also, you know, what, 19 years old. And so I went back and pulled out the one shining moment video we did of his shot against Houston last year and put it up on the site just to remind myself I'm 45. He's 19. Relax. Okay. Relax. Here's the final question. So I've got Michigan and Michigan State playing in the Final Four as well. I've got Virginia and Kentucky on the other side of the bracket. So I have the ACC and SEC on the other side. And I have Virginia beating Michigan State for the national championship. But here's my question. If you had a choice between losing in the Elite Eight to anybody and getting to the Final Four again, but losing a fourth time to Michigan State in the season, what is the more painful scenario for Michigan fans, do you think?
Michigan State. I'll take the loss to the Elite Eight in a heartbeat. If that scenario played out exactly like you're saying, and Michigan lost to Michigan State for the fourth time and they went to the national championship game, I don't think Michigan would ever live it down, honestly. I mean, other than winning a national championship before Michigan State, I don't think that you would ever live that down. And I know I had this conversation earlier. I don't think, other than going to the Final Four, I don't think Michigan lives down the fact that they lost to State 3 times this year. It would have to be either go to the Final Four or you make it to Elite Eight and State bows out in the second round and the narratives repeat themselves. I think you actually even, you know, responded to that tweet of mine that, if the narratives repeated themselves and Tom Izzo gets regarded as a guy the last couple of years who's choked in the NCAA tournament, then I guess it all equals out. But no, there's no scenario in the world where I can take playing Michigan State for a fourth time and losing. And yet, you know what, Steve? If they get a chance to play against Michigan State one more time, I mean, is it possible that a team could beat you 4 times in one season that you wouldn't learn from your mistakes, that Iggy and Jordan Poole would not be playing their best basketball? I mean, the difference between these two teams is not – it has not been 15 to 18 points. It's not like one team is killing the other. I mean, it's literally coming down to in this last game, the final 2 minutes. In the game before that, it was the game before that was about a 7-minute stretch. The one at Chrysler Center was about a 4-minute stretch. I mean, these games are being decided in 4 minutes where Michigan State's making the plays and Michigan's not. And so I would take my chances one more time. But I would say this, if Michigan and Michigan State were to play again in the Final Four and Michigan lost, I would I'd have a hard time showing my face around my house for a very long time.
Always good to talk to you, brother. Thanks for joining us here this week again on Michigan Podcast.
Thank you, guys. And you know what? Let's hope that scenario unfolds where we're talking about Michigan as a Final Four in a couple weeks. Next week, I'll be back. We'll be talking on this Michigan Podcast, and I look forward to talking about Michigan playing Buffalo in the Sweet 16.
Michael Spath from WTK and Ann Arbor and Wolverine Digest, and we will indeed talk to him again next week. We'll come back, wrap things up here in a moment. Thank you to all of you that are supporting us here on Patreon. We get asked frequently, hey, what can we do to support what you guys are doing here at Michigan Podcast? And one of the best ways to do that is to support us with a very inexpensive nominal contribution at Patreon. And as you can see, throughout the course of the year for our Patreon supporters, we do give you exclusive content we don't offer anywhere else, just as a way of saying thank you. So to all of you that have supported us throughout the year at Patreon, thank you. Thank you in advance to those of you who are willing to sign up and do so in the future, and go Blue. This week's Twitter poll, we asked you, do you agree with me? Do you think Michigan will win the West Regional of the NCAA tournament for the second straight year and make it back to the Final Four? A lot of votes in this one, and they were split, but 52% of you said no. So a lot of opinions on that. And I can see, let me put it this way. If you were laying odds, if we were bookmakers in Vegas, the odds would be against it. But and that's about what they would be, 52 to 48 against, right? You are the number two seed, you know. Gonzaga should be favored. They're the number one seed. I just think Michigan has the better draw and more of the profile of teams that are successful this time of year. Which brings me to this week's question of the week. And it comes from Richard, who says, do you agree our biggest issue is that we don't have a basket getter other than Iggy, meaning Iggy Brazdeikis? I don't agree with that. Actually, I think Michigan has one of the lineups capable of producing individual offense more than any team in the country. Jordan Poole can get his own offense. Xavier Simpson can get his own offense. Charles Matthews can get his own offense. Isaiah Livers, coming off the bench, can get his own offense. All right? Really, the only player in Michigan's regular rotation, if you don't count Eli Brooks, who doesn't seem to, you know, provide any offense. But if you look at, you know, Michigan's 6.5, 7-man rotation, the only player in that rotation that is reliant on the offense itself to get his production is John Teske. The rest of these guys can all produce their own offense. Richard, I think it's the opposite problem. I think they're all too aware they can produce their own offense. And I go to the Michigan State game on Sunday. 8 out of 9 possessions Michigan ran at a key juncture in that game were trash. And Michigan State's a really good defensive player, but in most of those possessions, we didn't make them play any defense. We just basically played the kind of basketball that Illinois has played for the last 15 years. It was just all hero ball. You know, one guy, no passing, 4 guys standing around, and, you know, one guy just jacks up a shot. It's a matter of it's, you know, 5 seconds into the shot clock or with 5 seconds left on the shot clock. All right, so I think, if anything, there's too much awareness of the amount of guys on the court that can get their own buckets. And there's too much of an over-reliance on individual play. So I don't think it's that they lack guys that can get their own offense. I think it's they're too aware that too many of their guys can get their own offense, that they stop playing together on that end of the court for long stretches. And to further my point on that, they don't seem to suffer on the defensive end, right? You know, so I think they kind of know this is who we are, and they have to fight that temptation to succumb to that at key times against elite competition like Michigan State. Well, let us know what you think about what we think. Again, you can check us out online at WolverineDigest.com. Follow us on Twitter at Michigan Podcast throughout the course of the week as well. And make sure you like, subscribe, 5-star review on the podcast platform of your choice, YouTube, wherever those options to give us positive feedback and share what we're doing here at Michigan Podcast apply. Also want to thank our friends at Detroit Sports Podcast, who each week help to get the word out about what we do here on every episode as well. Enjoy the madness. Let it commence. We'll be back at it again next week right here on Michigan Podcast. Go Blue.